I'll excuse myself beforehand because I believe the only thing that is standing between you guys and your freedom after this. This is also going to be a very detailed session with a lot of code samples, a lot of demonstrations. It's going to be a very detailed session, and it's especially focused on developers. So you'd have to be a little bit familiar with code, and you need to read code. And it's also a big plus if you can read a bit of JavaScript. So although it's 5 o'clock, and I know you guys have sucked up all this knowledge today, I hope you will still enjoy the session, and I hope I can teach you guys some stuff. But before we start, a short introduction about myself. I'm Chris. I'm from the Netherlands, Holland, and I'm a software architect for a company called Luminous, also a developer and a trainer. Full stack developer. I'll do the back end, and I'll also am very enthusiastic about front end technologies. On the back end part, I'll mainly focus on the Microsoft stack. So that's a bit rare coming here to like an open source convention. I can hear you people think, oh my, did he say the M word, the big M word? Yes. And wait till you see this. It's company policy for us to actually have MacBooks. But look what I'm running. I'm actually running, or you guys can't see it, I think. But I'm running Windows. I know, and people always telling me like that's taking the engine out of a car. But I need it for my work. So, and truth be told, I think this is probably the best Windows machine I ever had. It's fast, it never hangs, it's very stable also. The beautiful part about front-end development, and I'm talking about true single-page applications here, is that it does not matter which stack you are on. If you use the Java stack, or if you use Scala in the backend, or Dart, or the Microsoft .NET platform, such as myself, front-end development, the true single-page application development, it's all based on standards. You have the W3C standards in CSS, and in HTML and HTML5, and also the ECMAScript standards. So that's a big plus. I also do a lot of projects with some Java guys in the back end and myself in the front end. Feedback on the session. Tweet about it. You can also email me with questions, or if you would like to see the code samples, I'll send it back to you. So let's get started. This course of this presentation, I will first start with the AngularJS. How many of you here know AngularJS? I'll start. I'll go a bit faster then because I see a lot of raising hands, and I'm actually explain a bit of the basics and why would you want something like AngularJS. Also, I know that Angular 2 is final now. When I made this presentation, it wasn't final yet, and it was changing a lot. But I will factor Angular 2 into my explanation the whole time. So all those the code examples will be based on Angular 1. I will also explain a bit about Angular 2 and how things will work there. How many of you know TypeScript? It's a fewer hands, so probably I would take a bit longer to explain TypeScript, so you guys can learn a new language in just like under 40 minutes. And I will talk a bit about Require.js. And Require.js is just an example of a module loader. With Angular, you can use all kinds of module loaders, but it's basically more about the concept of module loaders. AngularJS, so I will go a bit. You will see me skip slides a lot. That's because I have way more slides than I could ever present in the time that we have. But it also allows me to scale the presentation a bit at runtime, or so to say, developer language, based on the needs of the audience. So why would you need AngularJS? How many of you guys, and I think that there'll be a lot, seeing that you already know Angular, know JavaScript? And how many of you here are really back-end developers that shy away from JavaScript and front-end development? Ah, those are nice to have, because I was exactly like that. And the goal of this presentation is not only to teach you guys some stuff about Angular and TypeScript, but it's also to show you guys that with the modern state of technologies and the current state of technologies, front-end development does not have to be like unstructured and weakly typed and moduleless. All the enterprise languages like Java, C Sharp, they have all those cool constructs. And when you go to the front-end for the first time as a back-end developer, it makes you, well, a bit scared because it's a big language and it's weird. But with the current state of technology, you can fix all that. And I really started liking front-end development because it's a really a good way of developing with like a language like TypeScript and frameworks like Angular. Things have changed a lot in the past. So why Angular? Of course, you have libraries like jQuery and Knockout. Knockout is just like a data binding framework. It doesn't force like an application architecture on your website, on your web application, like Angular does. And jQuery is just, basically, it's just a fancy way of questioning the DOM, right? Normally, you would do like document.getElementById. And jQuery makes that a lot easier. But jQuery does not solve the problem of mixing logic with presentation. Right? If you are doing jQuery a lot, then you are probably placing some UI logic inside a JavaScript file. And that's not what you want. And that's exactly what Angular tries to solve by forcing you into a certain pattern. And there are a lot of other frameworks that try to solve these problems also. But I really like AngularJS the best, and Angular 2 also. I think it has improved quite a lot. So I have a basic, a small example, and it's really not much more than a hello world. It is something different, but it's just to show you that if you use pure JavaScript and you will are trying to achieve something, then it takes a lot of work for what you get out of it. So I'm using the big clunky Visual Studio, but the beautiful thing about front-end development is you can do it almost with any IDE, really. You could do it with WebStorm also. Visual Studio Code is a nice free IDE that's also out there right now, and it's platform independent. I use Visual Studio Enterprise just because I'll need it also for my back-end development. I just need to open the project. It's like this. It can be a bit slow in the beginning, but it will get better. So this is really a small application. It's really ugly also. I do front-end development, but I am not a designer. So what it should do is you can type a course name, and if you search for it, then it should show a course like this one. And probably after me, some CSS Gandalf or CMS Dumbledore will go over this HTML and CSS and will make it way more pretty than I ever could. It will take me a really long time in CSS and HTML to just do this. But this is really, this application does almost nothing. It only shows, based on some input, it shows a course. And if you look at the code that it took to just meet this goal, then you would see it's a bit much. Or make it, is it readable for everyone, the code? I think. Or need to make it bigger. So you can see on the top there's about a bit of test data, but really, there's a lot of boilerplate code just to achieve this little piece of work, right? That is not what we want. We would like to write less code, focus more on real logic, business logic, functional logic of the application, and write less boilerplate code. Also, you can see here that there's a lot of UI logic, like this, to add nodes or to visualize a node inside my JavaScript. And that's mixing different kinds of logic. And that's what you don't want. So I will also take this example and take a look at Angular. before we do that, I'll explain a bit. So Angular, what is it? It's a framework that gives us two-way data binding. And data binding means that I can place some data as a user in the UI, and my variables in my code, it will automatically update. And also the other way around. So when I change some variables in my code or some properties, the UI will update also. And it does that automatically. So I don't have to use refresh statements or stuff like that. That's two-way data binding. But Angular does way more than only data binding. It also forces your application to think in an architectural pattern. And that's the model view controller pattern. So this will make sure that we will separate the UI logic from our real logic. How does Angular achieve this? With something that is called like directives. And those are special Angular snippets of code that you can place inside your HTML. You can see something like that in here. See the curly braces and the 4+8. And normally the browser would think, well, it would just render. It would think it's text. Because I have loaded Angular, Angular will try to read that expression and will add those numbers and actually give it an output. There's one more complex piece. So we have views, that's the HTML. We have the controllers, that's basically the class or function in JavaScript terms that is responsible to perform logic, get some data, stuff like that. And we have something that is called the scope. And scope are the glue between your controller and your UI. So from your controller, you will populate the scope with functions and with data. And the UI can show that data from the HTML. Scopes have changed a little in Angular 2. In Angular 2, scopes are more implicit. And whenever you are creating a component with a controller and HTML, properties on that controller are automatically consumable from your HTML. So you don't have to fill the scope anymore. Let's take a look. So this is my JavaScript file now. It's a bit empty. You can see here that I define an Angular module. And it's a logical cohesive unit that Angular supports. JavaScript has no module system, at least not in ECMAScript 5. In ECMAScript 6, it does. But Angular also has its own modules. So I'm creating a main module, so to say. Let's see. I will drag just an entire controller from here. If I'll have to type it all out, it would take too much time. So this is some code in Angular. And you can see here that I'm actually filling the scope. All right? Keep in mind that the controller in Angular, and it's just the same in Angular 2, it's just a JavaScript function. So this function starts here. It's an anonymous function. It will get the scope injected by Angular. And then I place some data on the scope. Here, scope.courses is, and then you see a big array, my test data. You can also see that I am placing a function, a search function, on my scope. So now these two things are actually reachable from my HTML code. Let's have a look. You can see here that this button has an ng click. And that is what Angular calls a directive. Those are those little pieces of Angular snippets that you can place in your HTML that Angular actually gets. And you can see that I specified just a function, the search function on the scope. So Angular will call that for me when somebody clicks the button. So I don't have to write that DOM code anymore to wire up the event handler. Right? That's just basic UI logic. There's another cool part here. And that has to do with this table. Look at this. This is a table. And I would probably want to show a table rows for each and every course that it will find, that the search function finds. In my previous example, you saw that I wrote a lot of DOM code for that, right? I was adding and deleting nodes. In Angular, it behaves a bit different. I can do something like this, ng repeat course in courses. And now I can delete. Let's have a look. I need to place it a bit higher. I actually want to repeat the entire div for each and every course. So I would play it. Just have a look if this matches. This means courses variable needs to be declared on the scope. Let's take a look if it is. Scope.courses. And you can see that the search function filters the current array and places the new filtered array in courses. This actually causes a bug, I see now, but for this example, it does not matter. And this is like a range variable. This variable is reachable from inside your loop. And here I'm just printing the course.name and the course.code. Those are two properties on a course. Let's have a look. It's the same application. And now it is working, but with a lot less code, right? And the code is a lot more cleaner. The scope, the controller only has the logic that it needs, like the search function. And the UI has the code that shows the nodes and make the nodes disappear based on my results. And this is a big part of what Angular tries to achieve. And this actually does not change between Angular 1 and Angular 2. So Angular has a lot of directives. You actually saw me use the ng repeat. There are a lot more in Angular. The ng click, I see a typo there, a really weird one. Oh, and the directive that I did not explain just now is this one, the ng model. It's used for a two-way data binding. So when you specify a field here, it's a variable on your controller function. Angular makes sure that that field gets populated with the data that the UI that the user places in the side text box. And you have some cool stuff to show and hide things based on a condition or a Boolean value. You can do that with ng-show or ng-if. Ng-if actually deletes nodes, and ng-show just hides them with CSS. I just did the courses with Angular demo. I can show the calculator demo. It's also a simple application. So, a very simple calculator. First, in Angular, you have to define a module. It's nothing more than this call. Then I can add a controller to that module. Something like this. And you again, you can see here that it's just a matter of filling scope, right? I'm placing an answer. I'm filling an answer here. And I'm placing this with the add. So from the UI, I can actually call this add function, and it will fill the answer for me. But first, we have to do some stuff here. When you work with inputs, it's normal to use in HTML to use forms. So Angular actually has a lot of stuff for forms. So I can add an ng submit here. And basically, I'm specifying here what should happen if a user submits this form. Well, I want to call the add function. So I can just specify add here. Don't forget the braces, it's actually a function call. Of course, I need an ng model on this one to provide two-way data binding. Number one, and number two. This, let's check if this actually dot number one, number two. This is okay, and that's it for now. You can also see that I'm using an ng show here to hide or show the answer based on the checkbox. See, the checkbox writes the Boolean value to answer visible, and I use that same answer visible in the ng show to make a decision if the answer should be shown or not. So let's see if this works. And there it is. This works. And again, it makes for cleaner code, for more separation of concerns. Questions can be at the end, in case we are running out of time. So, TypeScript. So Angular did a lot for us. Angular solved a lot of problems for us, and continues to solve a lot of problems for us. But JavaScript still has its own problems, right? And I know there are a lot of JavaScript purists out there that really like the language. I also like the language, but I also think that doing good JavaScript, writing real structured code, or writing object-oriented code, and especially for a lot of back-end developers, that will be the case, you are probably used to an object-oriented language. And JavaScript is not an object-oriented language per se. You can use it to write object-oriented code, but you have to put in a lot of work. There are a lot of complex patterns to actually create classes and to create inheritance in JavaScript. And we will dive into that a bit later, but it will also show you that's a lot of work. The type system of JavaScript, well, it's an untyped language. And if you come from a strongly typed backend language, like Java or C Sharp, that puts a lot of people off, mainly because the tooling, like your IDE and your developer environment, it will have more trouble. It makes it harder for the tooling to give you code completion and to give you IntelliSense, because it cannot make assumptions based on types that you predefined, like function parameters or return parameters. So JavaScript is a dynamic language, and in statically typed languages, you can see Java, C Sharp. When you look at object orientation, JavaScript is not a purely object-oriented language in the sense that it has no syntax support for it. You can write object-oriented code, but there is no class keyword. There's not a keyword to make inheritance possible. And again, there are a lot of patterns that can actually make sure that you have inheritance, but it takes a lot of work. I'm going to skip a few slides to this one, TypeScript. TypeScript is a language. It comes from Microsoft, actually, but it's completely open source, and it's based on the ECMAScript 6 standard. In ECMAScript 6, you actually have classes, and you have object-oriented inheritance, and you actually have modules. But you still do not have strong typing. Plus, the downside of ECMAScript 6 is that no browser currently supports all the features of ECMAScript 6. And TypeScript tries to fill that gap. With TypeScript, you can use the ECMAScript 6 features, at least a whole lot of them, without ever needing to run on a browser that actually supports ECMAScript 6. You can specify to the TypeScript compiler compile to ECMAScript 5 compatible code, or compile to ECMAScript 3 compatible code. And the browser will compile to just that, or sorry, the compiler will compile your TypeScript code to ECMAScript 5 compatible JavaScript code, and that will be the code that your browser interprets. So it will never know that you actually used those ECMAScript 6 features. Another big benefit of TypeScript is that it is object-oriented, and in combination with Angular, Angular uses the model view controller pattern, and that's actually also a pattern that leans a lot on object orientation. If you look at Angular 2, Angular 2 is especially built with TypeScript and for TypeScript. You can still use JavaScript, but TypeScript is essentially the way to go. So I'm going to skip this a little. This is the same as in JavaScript, the types that TypeScript have. I will single one out, and that's the string, because the string in TypeScript actually has some cool stuff. And I think I'll do a demo with that, just to show you guys that TypeScript has some cool stuff in it. Let's see if I can abuse this project for it, or I'll have to create a new project. Damn it. There it is, TypeScript. No. So I have a little demo here. So hello world is more appropriate, I think. And if I save it, it will get compiled. Just let me see if I can show you guys this. Yeah, there it is. There's nothing weird here, right? It's just, and you can see here that TypeScript basically is JavaScript. But there's also some cool stuff. For example, I can actually type my parameters. And this means that the tooling can give you a lot of better intelligence, actually. And this will work across functions. It will work across everywhere, because the tooling knows that you actually what the types are. But TypeScript has some other cool stuff. Let's say that I would have a name here. And this is actually a feature of ECMAScript 6 that I'm going to show you guys. And for it, you need to use, yeah, I thought so. My keyboard is set wrong. It's an Apple keyboard. You actually have to use a backticks to specify your string. Not this one, but the other one, Chris. And this one will use backticks, like this. And now I can use, you can see the IntelliSense, the code completion. And now I can actually use this variable as a template string. And this is a feature that a lot of JavaScript developers wanted for a long time. Because normally in JavaScript, you would have to like concatenate a string with plus, 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 plus. And this is a feature that comes from ECMAScript 5. Let me see what it's talking about here. Maybe, but I first name, I don't think so, but it could be part of the project. But you're right, thanks. But just have a look. Do you see what it compiles to? It just transpiled our code, or compiled your code, to ECMAScript 5 compatible code, because a lot of browsers don't implement ECMAScript 6 compatible features, or all the ECMAScript 6 compatible features. If I actually specify the compiler to compile it to ECMAScript 6 compatible stuff, you can do that right here. Let me see. This is all, you gotta love the UI that the Microsoft guys create. Look at this box. This is the box where I can specify to which ECMAScript version I would need to compile, but I cannot see the version. It's too small, unless you do this. Weird stuff. But anyway, if I recompile it, and let's see if it works, then you would actually see that it's pure JavaScript. It would take those backticks, it would leave it, because it's an ECMAScript 6 implementation detail now. Let me place it back. I see the time is running out very quickly, so I'm going to skip ahead. There are a lot of cool features in TypeScript that are going to single out, like the for-off loop. The JavaScript for loop is normally, it's a bit difficult when you loop over arrays. It actually gives you an index instead of the item in the variable. With TypeScript, you have just a normal for-off loop. So that's cool. But the really cool part, of course, comes with the object orientation. I'm going to skip a bit faster here. This is a class pattern, by the way, in JavaScript. This is what I was talking about earlier. It takes a lot of work to write really object-oriented JavaScript code. And even more work if you're going to use object-oriented inheritance, like with a person and a teacher and an animal and a dog. And you want to have the subclasses inherit the properties of the base class. That takes a lot of work, because JavaScript has prototypical inheritance. And it works a bit differently from object-oriented inheritance. But then, when you look at TypeScript, you have just this, a TypeScript keyword. I'm going to show you guys what this does. And I'm actually going to abuse that project again. I should not write in my JavaScript. And I'm going to do class a person. And I'm just giving it a name. Like this. So compile it. Just have a look. It's still has some errors, I think. I'll specify a subclass. It basically used the Java syntax for inheritance, not the C++ or C# syntax. And he has a course he can teach. Person is new teacher. Like this. And you can see that it looks a lot like just normal Java or C# object-oriented code. I still have to set it back to ECMAScript 5, I believe, because so, like this. And you can see that TypeScript actually generated a lot of code for you. Really a lot of code. And if you have to do this yourself, because you want to write object-oriented JavaScript, then this would take really a long time. Now, on to cooler things. You get the gist of the basic object orientation that is in TypeScript. So I'm going to skip ahead. And I'm going to look a bit at, yeah, we are right here, about how you're going to use this with Angular. This is the wrong one. So, if you are going to use Angular with TypeScript, then you basically can write just a truly object-oriented application in which your controller actually becomes just a class. You can see here that this controller, it has a constructor, it has a search method, it has the courses in there that we saw earlier from the demo before. And because it compiles to just JavaScript, it's actually the same HTML code, because the browser does not see any difference if you are using TypeScript or JavaScript. So creating an application with TypeScript in combination with the Angular framework, then you can create real structured code and an object-oriented, a truly object-oriented front-end application. But as you can also see, if you do this the right way, you are creating a lot of files, right? You are creating a course.ts file, courses.ts file, course controller, and this is just a really small application. So you will get a lot of separate JavaScript files. That means that this can become unmaintainable. You can see it actually here already starting to happen. I have a big list of separate JavaScript files in there that I will need to keep in the right order. Exactly in the right order. So JavaScript does not have modules, and that's exactly this problem is what modules are trying to solve. The ECMAScript 6 implementation specification has modules. For ECMAScript 5, there are actually a lot of module loaders. How many of you guys know module loaders? Okay, good to hear. You have like the AMD specification for module loading or the common JS specification. The one I am using is actually AMD, and that's called require.js. And the cool part is that require.js, let's have to see here. Require.js in itself is just a JavaScript framework. It knows nothing about TypeScript. So if you are using this, require.js can actually become a bit complex. And the same goes for other module loaders, unless you are using Node.js, because that has its own module loading system built in. But the browser does not. So then you have to do stuff like this. Right? That's not very maintainable, and the code will become hard to read. Luckily, TypeScript actually has support for modules. Some of you guys saw it already with the compiler options during my demo. I can actually specify which module system I want to use. And TypeScript will compile to the appropriate code for me. So TypeScript takes a lot of the complexity away from you when working with a module system like require.js. Let me show you what an application with require.js looks like. And I will grab this one. So, here we are. You can see from here, in this application, this is actually a part of a real-life application. I will demo it to you guys shortly. It has a lot of JavaScript files. I did make it anonymous for NDA reasons. But you can see here that there's only two script tags. One to load the module loader, require.js, and one to specify to require.js, well, what's your main method? What do you want to execute when all the modules are finished loading? And this is actually very cool because there is no big list of dependencies anymore. Each JavaScript file specifies the other JavaScript files that it needs to run properly. So the big list is gone. And if you use a build system, a Node.js build system like Gulp or Grunt, that's typically used in front-end builds, there are actually plugins for those to bundle all your JavaScript code based on require.js in one big JavaScript file, so the browser does not have to send a lot of requests to load all those separate files. Let's see what this looks like. You can actually see I have a lot of JavaScript files. These are all these folders contain JavaScript files. There's a patience part that contains a lot of controllers. There's a user part that contains a lot of stuff. So you can see that in a real-life single-page application that you are building with TypeScript and Angular, it grows. It grows exponentially, the number of files does. But if you look at, for example, the user controller, you can see here the syntax that you can use to specify which other JavaScript files this file needs to run. And let the module loader, let require.js take care of the rest. Let it figure out the dependencies and load it in the right order. So let's see if I can actually run this application. And I'm going to start a command line for that, but because this actually uses a build. Never mind the compiler errors for now. There it is. It's like I said, for NDA reasons, it's like anonymous now. It's called Patients R Us. You can log in, and there's basically a page. And this was part of an application that we created to make a collaboration between patients and doctors possible. But what is more interesting is when you look at the network tab here, and I'll switch back, and when I log in or something like that, you don't see any HTTP requests at all anymore. And that's because my build system actually bundled all the code in a JavaScript file. And there are even plugins for our build system with Gulp that is Angular specific. So I can use my build system to actually say these HTML files generate a JavaScript file that places these HTML files in the Angular template cache. So there is no runtime loading. It's one-time load. And afterwards, there are no requests anymore. It's bundled to all one big file. And I believe you can actually see that one if you look at the sources. You can see here our main.js that's really big. And it doesn't make Chrome crash, but also uglified and stuff like that. So that's the last part that I want to give to you guys, is if you're doing these kinds of application with Angular and TypeScript and require.js or another different module loader, also look into a front-end build system like Node.js, Gulp, or Grunt. I believe that's it for today. Are there any questions? Yes. Is there a mic somewhere to?
I have two questions. First question, Can we use existing JavaScript libraries with TypeScript?
Yes, very good question, and I will show you guys that. And of course you can, because it's all just JavaScript, but you are probably wondering about the type information, right? You have something like, I don't have the internet connection right now, but I can show you that here. The open source community has created definition files, and they end in .d. And that makes the TypeScript compiler know what types there are in your JavaScript library. For example, you can see here, for AngularJS, I actually have a D file, a definition file, that actually specifies all the interfaces and classes that Angular supports. So whenever I'm typing the Angular variable in my code, let's see if I can do that here or in the controller maybe. You will get complete IntelliSense and type information. So the short answer is yes, and you can also have completely code completion and type information and all the IntelliSense that you want, because almost for every JavaScript library out there, there is a definition file available. You can just download them. And there's also a lot of tooling in Node.js that downloads them for you and saves them to a JSON file, so you can restore all the definition files in the next build or on your build server. Does that answer your question?
Yes, one more question. I have seen that at the end we have one big JavaScript file.
Yes.
How we debug that? If we...
Good question. Also, you can actually see in my build system here that I have different tasks. Let me see. This is the distribution build. And this RES plugin here, that's the part that bundles them all in one build. But when I run a development build, like this one, I don't have to use the same steps. Also, there's another thing that you can use, and that works with bundling, and that's called source maps. Have you ever heard of it? The TypeScript compiler supports source maps, and that's actually also supported. It's a standard, and it's also supported by Chrome. You can see it on the developer tab. Let me see here if I can get somewhere to the settings. There should be something here about use source maps. I can't find it right now. But I can show you that. Oh, sorry, did somebody saw it?
You have it first source, enable JavaScript source.
Yes,
maps.
Exactly. It's a standard. And every browser supports it. And the TypeScript compiler supports it also. So in Gulp, you can actually generate source maps, then perform the bundling, and generate the source maps for after. And then the browser will just show you the TypeScript code. And this actually gives you the possibility to debug the TypeScript code from inside your browser instead of the JavaScript code. Does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you very much.
Any other questions? Yes.
Hello. What is your opinion on comparison between Angular 1X and React in terms of performance and learning curve? That's one question.
React is also, I even saw some projects that use them both in combination, actually create Angular components using React. React is a bit more on the UI side. And some people, it's also a matter of personal preference, because some people really like React. But what I like less about React is that it starts mixing UI and logic again. And that's why I like Angular better. And in terms of performance, I have no performance metrics between the two. So.
Okay. Another question. When do you expect that companies using Angular 1 will port their front end of applications to Angular 2?
Soon? For me, all the projects that I am doing currently, I will not port to Angular 2 very soon, because although it is final, it's still changing a lot. And the tooling is not final. You have like a big command line tool that's still in a beta. But I think when I start a new project, I will try to base it off Angular 2. So I think Angular 2 will probably gain a lot of traction and mainstream in half a year or so, probably. But if you go new projects and you want to learn Angular, I would start with Angular 2, because in a sense, Angular 2 is actually simpler to learn than Angular 1. It's become a lot simpler.
Thanks.
Yes.
Hello.
Hello.
Just a follow-up on the last question. What would be the basic steps of going from 1 to 2?
If you set up your application like I did here, then you don't have that many steps. The basic steps, because as you can see here, that I put all my logic in controllers instead of in TypeScript controllers instead of anonymous functions that fill a scope. If you go about, if you went about your application in that way, you don't have a lot of work porting your code. Only the really specific stuff like Angular directives, custom directives that you created, you need to port that. Of course, the pieces that the scope that use the scope, you need to port. But it's not really that much, because there's also a shim available for Angular 2. There's actually a library available from Angular itself, from the Angular team, that makes porting your application to Angular 2 more easy, because your application can actually use both of them at the same time. So it becomes like in a hybrid state. So you can actually port it incrementally and not all at once. Does that answer your question?
Thank you.
More questions? Okay, that's it, I think. Thank you.